I feel we're getting better at using technology as a tool, as a force multiplier to increase efficiency and the value we create for our clients.
Thank you for joining us on the very first episode of Infrastructure Insights. On this podcast, we feature casual conversations and some geeking out about the infrastructure supporting the world around us. Our innovative problem solvers are engineers, geologists, and environmental scientists who are passionate about creating a better tomorrow. On Infrastructure Insights, we will share stories, best practices, and trends that span the world and range from complex technical topics to the latest developments in technology applications. Get ready to geek out with us. I'm your host, Michelle Bosco, Communications Specialist at Burgess & Nightbull. Joining us today is Mark Bernhardt, President and CEO of BNN. Mark, welcome to the show and thank you for being here.
Thanks, Michelle. I'm excited to take part in this conversation today. I've been with Burgess & Nightbull now about 23 years. Came up through the Bridge Inspection Group and the Transportation Group in Columbus, Ohio. And I've always seen BNN as a company that's focused on making a long-term positive difference in the world. I see BNN as a good corporate citizen, and our employees have always been focused on improving the quality of life for folks in the communities where we work and live. There's always a health and safety aspect to what BNN is doing, clean water, safe bridges, reducing car crashes through our infrastructure projects. I think some reason that I was drawn to this, and I think many were drawn to this occupation, is it provides an opportunity to use our skills and knowledge for good and create and build things.
I've noticed that as well, being at BNN, that everyone's really committed to improving the community around them. Can you talk about some of the moments that have really impacted you in your career?
Absolutely. I think one of the most powerful ones, or a series of experiences, was following the I-35W bridge collapse in Minnesota. The I-35W bridge was built in the late 1960s across the Mississippi River. In 2007, it experienced a catastrophic collapse while carrying traffic. A number of drivers and passengers and cars were killed or injured as a result of this tragic event. Certainly, that was a major event in the United States. It impacted BNN a lot. We had a lot of immediate work in the follow-up to that, where we went out and did some safety inspections of quite a few similar bridges around the country. Additionally, following that, got involved in crafting legislation, working with some folks in D.C., and eventually that led to some testimony in Congress, where we had a chance to, you know, try to do our part to help shape policy and help create legislation that would ultimately make infrastructure safer for the traveling public. And certainly that was a pretty stark instance of where we really had a chance to use our knowledge to make the world a safer place.
Can you expand on some of BNN's assistance in crafting that new legislature? Why were we a part of the process? How did we influence change to make the country's bridges safer?
Sure. Following the collapse, a congressman from Minnesota, James Oberstar, who at the time was a member of the House Transportation Committee, wanted to put together and introduce a bill that would strengthen bridge inspection standards and would provide additional funding for states to improve the condition of their deficient bridges. His staffers reached out to a number of engineers in the bridge inspection community from throughout the country to provide review and comment and input on the contents of this bill.
So were you a key part of, you know, being involved in that?
I think the congressman had kind of reached out to, I'm guessing, folks in different, professional organizations, state organizations that dealt with inspection. Some of those were professional organizations that I was involved with. So I'm guessing most likely my name just came up as part of that, as someone who had been out there.
Okay. So I guess that goes to show how important it is to be involved in those professional organizations and kind of put yourself out there and make a name for yourself.
Absolutely. Absolutely. If you want to, you know, if you want to influence your area of practice, you gotta step forward, I guess.
Did you testify as a part of this?
ACEC had reached out to me and asked if I would testify before a congressional committee on the state of bridge inspection and bridge safety within the United States at the time.
Wow, that's a really big deal.
It was. It was something I was happy that I had the opportunity to do that, and once again, a chance to kind of share some more of the details of what bridge inspection was really like, kind of from a boots on the ground perspective to, you know, folks within Congress who may not have that, have that firsthand knowledge, obviously.
That's a horrible thing that happened, but, you know, a really good example of how you and BNN have been able to make an impact and really improve the safety of our communities. What other experiences have impacted you and your career?
Yeah, I mean, some of the other things that come to mind, I've you know, had the opportunity. I have a love of travel. I love getting out and exploring new places and having experiences in that sense and traveling around. And one of the things that really drew me to BNN was the chance to work on projects all over the United States, and have always enjoyed that. You know, some of my favorite ones are up in Alaska, where we would, you know, we would rent a boat, a big boat with a captain, and go around to different little villages and inspect their docks and their bridges, and live on the boat as we traveled from location to location. Great scenery, great experiences, getting to do some engineering too. Lots of fun, those types of projects. We've had interesting jobs throughout the United States. My first job at BNN was going to New York for a couple of months and working on some big suspension bridges, the Bronx Whitestone Bridge in New York City. That was a lot of fun and a good way to kick off my career. But really, it's all boiled down to the people. I think within the bridge inspection group that I was part of for so many years, there were folks from offices around the company that were involved in that practice, and all of the jobs were kind of a number of people from different offices from around the company all working together to get something done. And it really was a chance for me to get to know the people throughout the firm. And I guess that's the one thread that's been consistent, is the great people at BNN, and, you know, all of the great experiences I've had and the interesting projects I've had the opportunity to work on, they've been made better because of the people that I've gotten to work with.
You talked about your time, you know, in New York on these huge bridges. Can you talk about how, from that time until now, some of that technology has changed and some of the inspection techniques that have changed?
Absolutely. Absolutely. That's certainly, you know, I guess it's going on 25, 30 years that I've been doing this now. You know, one of the most important advances, I think, would be around safety, advances in rock climbing equipment that has been adapted for the kind of industrial rope access that we do on structures, that made our work at height inspecting structures much safer. I think that's probably the most important thing, is that it's a much safer occupation than it was when I started. And a lot more training now. I think the requirements around training are a lot more robust now. There's outside certification organizations such as SPRAT, which is the Society of Professional Rope Access Technicians, that has a very robust and regimented training and experience, inspection, testing, qualification program to become an official certified worker at height. So that's kind of from the safety and climbing aspect of it. You know, on the tools and technology side, like all the other aspects of our world, technology has had a dramatic impact on what we do and how we work in the field. Our inspectors at BNN are now fully digital and integrated with cloud-based databases. They use iPads and other smart tablets that collect data and share it between the crews in the field and the office in real time. These wired inspectors can focus more effort on finding the problems, diagnosing the problems associated with the structure, and spend less time on information management, shuffling papers. Also, these devices allow the inspection team to have the entire bridge file, old reports, plans, inspection manuals, out on the bridge with them for easy reference at any time. To some of the augmented reality, mixed reality type stuff, you know, we can take those types of tools out on the bridge and display information for the inspectors while they're out on a structure, kind of in a right in front of their field of view, kind of a heads up display, so they don't even have to pull out their iPad or tablet computer to type things in. It can be displayed right in their field of vision. We're seeing certainly an advancement in recent years of what's called digital twins, or real-time digital replicas of the physical structure. Those models, those digital repositories of information, the digital twins, are now starting to be created for major bridges. Drones, our inspectors now have a fleet of drones, and we have pilots that can carry out a wide array of scanning and inspection tasks. Not only use these drones for structural inspection tasks, but we also use them for thermal scanning of building envelopes and inspection and scanning of pipeline networks and roof systems, as well as mapping and delineation of wetlands. Instrumentation is another aspect of inspection that's been evolving. There's been an evolution in the structural health monitoring equipment that can be applied to bridges. One can collect and analyze real-time data remotely on bridge behavior and response to load in order to make better data-driven decisions on bridge repair and service life. And a lot of that can be done remotely from back in the office, which is nice. We have bridges instrumented now in Arizona, and we can, you know, pull them up on our screen and in real time see what's happening on those bridges. There was actually a semi-trailer accident on one of those bridges in 2020, and the DOT was and I think there was a fire on the bridge in conjunction with that accident. And of course, the DOT was concerned as to what influence that fire and crash would have on the bridge's structure. But since we were monitoring the bridge, we were able to just pull it up, go to the bridge's website, if you will, and see what, if any, detrimental effects that crash and fire had to the overall load carrying capacity of the bridge in real time, and be able to provide answers to the DOT without actually having to send our inspection crews out to the bridge. That's kind of an example of how that's evolved.
That's awesome to be able to just pull that up and see immediately what's going on versus taking the time and resources to send people out.
These are bridges on Interstate 15 in Northwest Arizona. It's on the NAFTA truck route, and that stretch of interstate runs between Las Vegas and Salt Lake City and this isolated canyon in the northwest portion of Arizona is very remote, kind of off the grid. It's about an 8-hour drive from Phoenix, so to your point of it taking a long time to get up there, it's an 8-hour drive from Phoenix, where the Arizona DOT's headquarters is. So having that bridge instrumented so they can open it up, go to it on the web and see what its performance is from their offices in Phoenix is really beneficial.
You know, about a year ago, we kind of abruptly had to adjust to working from home, and we've stayed remote essentially ever since. Because working with people and collaborating is such a huge part of what we do, how were we able to make that adjustment successfully? And then how does that play into the new things we're doing this year and beyond?
No, that's a great question. I mean, certainly 2020 and the events of the year certainly took us all by surprise. You know, we're always doing scenario planning to try to create a vision in our minds of what the future might look like. And a global pandemic was never really high on the list of things that were going to dramatically impact our business that we were going to prepare for. But fortunately, some of the foresight that the leadership we had in place before I was president or CEO, Ron Schultz and others, had the vision that mobile technology, creating a mobile workforce, creating a platform where you could bring the best of D&N to bear anywhere on any project from wherever they were working, led to the creation of the VDI platform a number of years ago. And fortunately, by the time, you know, early 2020 rolled around, we had our VDI up and running. All of us were well used to working in that platform that really makes it seamless to share work between offices. So I think that was critical to our successful pivot to remote working. But I think most importantly, because so many of our offices are smaller, when we're delivering projects, it always very often requires people from multiple offices working together on these projects. So we already had, you know, this network of relationships developed throughout the firm that had been established. So, you know, what we were used to working with people remotely in other offices on projects. So it really wasn't too much different when entire offices went remote as well, too. Certainly that's not saying it hasn't been a challenge. And, you know, I think some of the, challenges that are most pronounced are, you know, supervising employees, you know, getting a good sense of staying connected with people. I think all of us have gotten Zoom fatigue over the last years. We get tired of communicating constantly throughout the year over a screen all the time. So it's certainly been a challenge, but I think the relationships we had in place before we went to remote work and some of the technology tools we had in place have allowed us to still be successful through the podcast as well as our other communication channels. Our goal was to really generate more engagement with our brand and awareness by our BNNers, all of our stakeholders, what we're doing to improve our communities, grow and develop our staff and build a better BNN. And I think, you know, one of the most important things we want to accomplish in the coming year is to emerge from the pandemic and safely return to our office in larger numbers. You know, reconnecting with our clients and fellow BNNers in person, most of which we've only seen virtually or talked to over the phone for the past year. That's one of the things I'm most excited about, is getting us back to the offices in greater numbers.
So we recently rolled out an updated strategic plan. Can you explain what that is, what it consists of, and how that's going to shape the future of BNN?
Absolutely. I mean, we're really excited to be rolling that out. Our strategic priorities remain talent, growth, and technology. You know, certainly talent, the people we have in this company, that is, you know, by far the most important thing to focus on. You know, the number one priority is, you know, developing the talent we have, retaining the talent we have, finding other great folks to come work here at Burgess & Nyepel. If we have great people, then everything else, I think, kind of falls into place. Growth is still important for us as a firm, and it's growth that creates space for those developing employees. We have a sense of stewardship at Burgess & Nyepel. I want to leave the company better than I found it. I want to leave the world a little better than I found it. Stewardship means having ambition and resilience to overcome obstacles and keep pursuing the mission indefinitely into the future. It's kind of an infinite company mentality. So part of that growth piece is to create sustainable, resilient offices that continue to survive indefinitely in the future. Technology is going to continue to impact our business. I feel we're getting better at using technology as a tool, as a force multiplier to increase efficiency and the value we create for our clients. I'm very excited to see how we've begun embracing emerging technologies such as AI and augmented reality and virtual reality. These technologies will absolutely exert more influence on our industry in the coming years. And it's imperative that we have curious staff who wish to experiment with these technologies. We put together a group of about, I think, 21 people from throughout the company at all different levels in the company as a kind of a strategic planning committee, if you will. I think you need that diverse cross-section of the company to get, you know, all of the different perspectives. So the strategic planning committee, those 21 people kind of looked at all of this stuff. The group kind of had some brainstorming sessions and thought through a host of different growth campaigns as well as stretch goals for growth. And I guess, as I mentioned earlier, too, we're going to be focusing more attention on staff training and development as well, supervisors, leadership training, with emphasis on, you know, development of soft skills, too.
Yes. So that kind of goes into my next question. What really cool things do we have in store at BNN in 2021?
Yeah, one of the things we're most excited into on the technology side is that kind of mixed reality, which is blending augmented reality and virtual reality. The augmented reality with the HoloLens. The HoloLens is a Microsoft product that represents their take on an augmented reality device. Using multiple sensors, advanced cameras, and optics, it creates holographic-type images in the field of view of the wearer. We've already had some success using that technology to help us win projects and differentiate us from our clients. The Parkersburg office utilized some of the capabilities of the HoloLens last year to create a virtual model of the New River Gorge Bridge that they pulled into a presentation at the West Virginia DOT, and I think helped position us to win that job, the inspection and work on the New River Gorge Bridge for another 6-year cycle. We're continuing to look for ways to integrate that into our project delivery process and look for opportunities to demonstrate it to clients. It's really important for us as a firm to understand all of this new emerging technology and how it can impact our business, what it can do, what it can't do, so we can act as advisors to our clients to let them know how they best can implement it within the things that they're trying to get done as well, too.
That's great. And, you know, I really appreciated from my first day here how much of an emphasis there was on technology and just being open to trying new things. And even if it doesn't work out, just at least taking the chance to experiment with it and see what it could do and couldn't do.
I'm a huge fan of experimentation. And really, it's important for us to create space and create an environment where our employees know that they've got room to experiment. I think sometimes we as engineers and architects and technicians get caught up on not wanting to do something unless we know for sure it's going to be 100% successful. And I think that holds us back sometimes. I think it's very important too to, you know, try to integrate something new on a project each time you do it to increase efficiency or add value. And sometimes it will and sometimes it won't. But eventually, I think as you do enough of those experiments, you slowly have this process of continual improvement in what you're doing. You know, we've adapted and evolved over the years as a firm, as the world has changed, and we've been able to stay relevant. And that willingness to change, grow, and adapt many times over the past century is something not every firm can do. I'm very proud to work at a firm that's been in business for 100 years. And I think we've had that. We've always embraced a continuous improvement process that's built around taking calculated risk, capital efficient risk to innovate creatively within constraints. And I think that's important. Along those lines, too, I think we do a great job of empowering our employees and letting them know that they can lead and influence from anywhere in the organization, whether that is driving some type of innovation tool or technology. I think no matter where you sit in the organization, you have the ability to lead and influence from there. And I've always personally felt that this opportunity existed being in, and I hope others do as well.
And I think innovation is a buzzword that's thrown around a lot, but I think the BNN actually does a really, really good job of actually innovating and not just saying, oh, we're innovators, but we are trying new things constantly and tweaking if it doesn't work and then moving on to the next thing to see how we can improve that.
You know, one of the things that I think makes BNN a great company is we have this deep bench of technical experts. Whether it's on the water, wastewater side or the transportation side, and you know, sharing that knowledge around the company is so important. But lots of exciting projects going on around the company. And I know we've got a nice on-call contract IDIQ with NASA that's generating different task work. So I think that's exciting to be part of as the space race ramps back up. We've got, you know, Mars mission going on right now and the Mars rover with the drone on Mars. So to be, you know, involved with NASA, I think that's an exciting project for us to be involved with. But there really are things big and small going on all over the company. Some of the stuff with artificial intelligence that the UI group is working on in Columbus, as that continues to get developed, I think that gives great stuff for us to talk with our clients about. We're really working too on trying to figure out a virtual reality platform that we can use for interoffice collaboration as well as collaboration with clients on projects. What I'm most excited about in 2021 is hopefully emerging from the pandemic and, you know, safely returning to our offices in large numbers and reconnecting with clients and fellow BNNers.
Mark, thank you so much for your time.
All right. Have a good one.
Thanks. You too.
Thank you for joining us for the first episode of Infrastructure Insights. Make sure to like, subscribe, and check us out on LinkedIn and Instagram.